everybody.
Jesus
Christ. Where's my crack pipe? Where's my bump? Damn dogs. Fuck that guy, dude. Seriously. Fucking crackheads and everything. Oh, our numbers went up right when I said woo! Fucking crackhead. Fuck face chaos, I swear to God.
Well, I mean, they said our name. Someone said our name on their show.
So. I'm sorry, guys. Look, here's a message to the unwrites. Seriously, learn how to control your own stream and don't just freaking accuse random people that you don't like of being some random troll that came into your fucking into your stream, man. Get a life. Right?
And, buddy?
It went up even more!
I just have one thing. Hey, buddy. Keep our name out of your fucking mouth.
Spit that dick out of your mouth when you're trying to pronounce my last name.
All right. Let's do this. All right. Let's do this. I agree with you, though. Cosmo!
Hey, Cosmo!
What's up, hon? How are you? Hiya,
Cobb! The Wendigo was everywhere.
That Wendigo, man. Susan, hey!
Hi, Susan.
Glad to see you in here. I see Calvin. Hey!
Hey, Calvin, what's going on?
And... Jeff, what's up? Ivar, hey! Mm. How are you?
Which one's Ivar? I forgot.
The yard for Washington.
Oh, hey, how's it going?
Hey, Ivar.
How's it going? Your yarliness? I don't know. I'm just fucking around, dude. I'm sorry.
Yay!
That's awesome.
All right, my eye is bright.
All right,
red.
We are.
So yeah.
What we doing today, dog?
God, don't do that.
I'm sorry.
That makes me want to punch something. Okay, so first off, I guess I'm going to start with this.
Warning.
Under the fair use, another author may make limited use of the original author's work without asking permission pursuant to the 17 U.S. Code 107, certain uses of copyrighted material for purposes such as criticism, comments, news reporting, teaching, including multiple copies for classroom use, scholarship, and research, or research, is not an infringement of copyright. So take that, Zucker douche. And warning, the related content may be disturbing to some individuals. Viewer discretion is advised. Trigger warning, and apparently seizure warning too.
Seizure warning. Should we put up the awesome one?
And warning, this video contains super awesome content not suitable for people who do not enjoy super awesomeness. Viewer discretion is advised. So tonight we're talking about Dennis Rader, the one, the only BTK, that giant douchebag.
You know, giant douchebag, but very smart douchebag. You have to give him credit where credit is due. Excuse me, I burped. I am drinking a beer. He evaded police. Fuck, since like 1977, was caught in 2005.
Not even that high of an IQ.
No, but was smart enough to write terribly. Was stupid enough to use a floppy disk.
I'm sorry, Calvin. Sitting here. Watching y'all and trying to get high enough to see you from Indiana.
I got, we got some edibles here that's like,
By the way, it's completely legal in California where we're located.
Crack's not legal here. It's not.
Okay, crack is not legal. Apparently it's legal in Texas sometimes.
It's legal in the trailer parks in Texas, I'll tell you that.
No, and by the way, I don't care if you live in a trailer park. I just don't hate these particular people. They're all pieces of shit. Those one pieces of shit clowns. This says 2,000 milligrams.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo! Any Hoosier, let's get Douche Canoe Rader.
He is a Douche Canoe.
Douche Canoe?
He's a Douche Canoe.
Douche Canoe.
No, he's a very, very terrible person. But
Susan, so there.
So there. He's but he was very, like I said, you gotta give credit where credit was due. He is very smart.
Hey!
Hi, Charles.
How are you doing? He's also in the Brotherhood.
Oh, that's awesome.
What's up?
That's Rat Fink right there, right?
That is not Rat Fink, but it looks like the same artist.
It's the same. I mean, that's not Rat Fink, but it's the same artist who does. But yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Or it could be Coop Art. But
isn't that like kind of generalized though? Like all that art is basically considered like Rat Fink now because it's so Rat Fink. It's more so considered popular.
Like Rob Zombie, but
yeah, if there's Rob Zombie, Sharon Moon Zombie would be on every piece of it. Like every aspect of it. If Rob Zombie,
I'm not upset by that.
I'm not upset by either. But if Rob Zombie did remake Godzilla 1954, Sharon Moon Zombie,
Sherry
Moon Zombie would play Godzilla. No joke.
Topless, might I add. Topless. And I would watch that.
Topless and just it'd be awesome if it was what's her face from She's all, Devil's Rejects.
and her roars, titty fucking freaky.
Okay, now we got to sell the idea of Rob Zombie. We have to.
It's just she comes out, she goes, titty fucking freaky, and knocks something over.
We got to get Rob Zombie to get a hold of Toho Studios and buy or get the rights to Godzilla Gojira 1954 and him remake it with Sherry Moon Zombie as Gojira.
All right, so we totally got off track. But let's get into talking about this douche canoe, Dennis Rader.
Yep. Well, you'll see right here when we read his letter why I think he's actually not.
Do you want to read the letter first?
No, let's get to the murders, his first murders, which his first murders was actually a family. But we'll get to that.
All righty. So, Dennis Lynn Rader, born March 9th, 1945, is an American serial killer known as BTK. Do you guys know what that means?
Bind, torture, kill.
Kill. Yep.
He gave himself his own nickname.
And it stuck.
It did. He was one of the only people in history who was able to give himself a nickname.
Well,
and
not
stuck.
One of the only, but
one of the only douche canoes hit.
One of the biggest douche canoes that got it to stick.
Yep.
I mean, Son of Sam.
Well, he gave the police in his first letter a giant list of nicknames.
Zodiac.
Zodiac was Zodiac. That's hard to not call him the Zodiac. He looks like something to do with the Zodiac. That's...
But he doesn't look like anything. Nobody exactly. knows what he looks
well,
like.
Just the crosshairs you and everything
can't
on his.
See me.
The crosshairs was on his forehead and chest, wasn't it? Or no, it was just. I think it was just the forehead, wasn't it? And then the dark silent sunglasses.
Anyway, my brain stopped.
The Zodiac was definitely the best dressed killer besides Ted Bundy.
All right, so BTK Strangler or the BTK Killer. Between 1974 and 1991. Dennis Rader killed 10 people in Wichita and Park City, Kansas, and sent taunting letters to the police and the newspaper describing the details of his crimes. So after a decade-long hiatus, he resumed sending letters in 2004, leading to his arrest in 2005.
This is...
How many have given themselves names and stuck? That is a good question, Ivar.
Most of the ones that have given themselves names... or it's usually the news agencies that actually give them their nicknames and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I mean, Night Stalker belonged to
the... They had to use that twice.
They had to use it twice, but it really, like, Richard Ramirez really took that name. That is his name.
You know why, though? Because they didn't catch Joseph DeAngelo until like, he was, like, 74. That was 2018.
Was it 2000? I thought it was 2017.
17 or 18.
Yeah, but yeah.
Regardless, a year apart, whatever. And he was a cop.
Yeah, that was annoying.
So, you know what, Ivar? I'm going to look that up, and I will get back to you.
I don't think Ted Bundy gave him, or Ted Bundy. Well, technically, Ted Bundy and Edmund Kemper were both co-ed killers. They were.
No.
I mean, I know.
Kemper was the co-ed Kemper was hugger.
It was the co-ed animatio.
The co-ed animatio.
Guys, look. Ivar and everyone else here, go check out, go Google Irimatio.
Oh, God.
It's going to take you probably to Brazers, but you're going to see some funny stuff.
Hey, Angie.
Hi, Angie.
How are you? Long time no see.
I was meaning the last week to check up on you and see how you're doing, and I'm sorry I got busy this week. I apologize.
By the way, you have a really cute kitty cat. I saw little toe beans. Very cute. All right, so he was arrested in 2005, and subsequently actually pled guilty. He is currently serving 10 consecutive life sentences at El Dorado Correctional Facility. I'm here to cause chaos.
Say the name three times. Let's make him appear. How about that?
Oh, God.
Someone send them the link.
Not to you, Angie, sorry.
No, Angie, you're awesome.
I'm here to kick ass and chew bubble gum, and I'm all out of bubble gum.
I was about to say I'm all out of ass.
I'm all out of ass. I'm here to
chew ass and kick bubble gum, and I'm all out of bubble gum.
All right, so let's get into his life and background. Dennis Rader was born, again, I said this earlier, March 9th, 1945, to Dorothea May Rader, Knee Cook. And
Knee Cook?
Knee, it means maiden name.
Oh, I was like, Knee Cook.
Yeah, it's a Knee Cook. Oh. No, Knee means maiden name.
Okay.
And William Elvin Rader, one of four sons. His brothers are Paul, Bill, and Jeff.
Was he a Raiders fan?
I don't know.
I swear to God.
I met a dog named Raider today.
If he was a Raiders fan, that would fit him. I'm sorry. No Raiders.
Ugh. So, sources give Raider's place of birth as either Columbus, Kansas, or Pittsburgh, Kansas. He grew up in Wichita. Both parents worked long hours and paid little attention to their children at home, so they were latchkey kids. And Rader would later describe feeling ignored by his mother in particular and resent her for it.
Which he also, too, got into the whole bondage porn at a very young age. I think his father would bring home the bondage porn and he would sneak into the room and stuff like that and find it. And he was enamored by it. Like, constantly. We can't show any of the pictures of him binding himself up, because there's a lot where it does show his no-no bits.
This is some, like, intense shibari, okay?
This guy was insane with how he took the pictures. He set up his own rig and went and tied himself up in trees, like, arms back like this, neck all ajar.
It's skill! I'll give him credit for that!
Set up a camera to take pictures of himself.
It's some skillful...
tied up like the women he murdered.
It's some skillful tree shibari.
Yeah.
So, from a young age, Rader harbored sadistic sexual fantasies about torturing trapped and helpless women. He exhibited zoo sadism by torturing, killing, and hanging small animals, which is one of the trifecta for the serial killers.
Well, they actually think, because he had about a 15-year cooldown period. Hey, Richard!
What's up, Richard?
What is up?
Hey!
When are you going to come over, man?
Hey, we need to burn some meat.
We need to meet some burn. I don't know. Whatever you want to do, man.
That sounds like it needs, like...
I'm sorry, I'm Raider. Charles Breeze.
Oh, we're playing. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry you're a Raiders fan, too.
I'm sorry I'm a Raiders fan. It's not my fault I dressed this way.
I'm just kidding. Go Broncos. Go Broncos.
Where's my Broncos stuff?
I don't know. Oh. I don't know. I think we left it in the other room.
ASAP, fire me! It's okay, Charles. We love you anyway. We love you anyway. Okay. So where was I? So Rader acted out sexual fetishes for voyeurism, autoerotic asphyxiation, and cross-dressing. He often spied on female neighbors while dressed in women's clothing, including women's underwear that he had stolen and masturbated with.
Okay, that's another thing, too, with Rader. He never raped any of his victims. Not one. Squirrel!
I told Ivar to tell me when I squirrel out.
He never raped any of his victims. All he did was...
Jack off in their panties didn't know he had?
Once they were dead. Once they were dead, that's when he did his business over them.
Angie, where?
But no, seriously, once they were dead, that's when he did his business over them. He never penetrated them, never did any of that stuff. Not one of them.
So he would masturbate with the stolen underwear with ropes and other bindings around his arms and neck. So basically, shibari panty jack off.
Yeah.
We're so getting taken down for this. I'm so getting taken down for this one.
Well, all the new trolls and all that stuff are going to come over from what's the cunt rights or whatever they're called, and we're they're going to be reporting us.
So years later, during his cool off period, between murders, basically.
Well, I am going to say this: I do believe it when they say he didn't. It's just the 10 people. he was very vocal about what he did, and he elaborated only on the murders, and he didn't try to fluff himself up to make himself be the bigger murderer. He literally was happy to tell about us, talk about
meow.
Stephen B. Kitty, hey, we are so sorry about running the reruns on Monday.
We lost all kind of all internet connection.
Yeah, our laptop also decided to stop connecting to the internet. That's the reason why we weren't on last Friday. Is where we were at. It was all jacked up.
No, he actually was not a necrophiliac.
No.
But I guess.
Okay, no, he didn't fiddle with the dead, but he did. their cold blue flesh turns me red.
Makes me turn red. Because I could do what I want and they won't come plain.
I want to fuck.
Okay. Anyway, no, he was not a necrophiliac.
No.
But he did get off by the act of murder.
He got off by the act of the control aspect of it. That's where he splooged his pants most of the times. Most of it actually took place when he was killing the person. That's when he came a lot of serial killers do, like the Rostov Ripper.
Oh man, Susan has to go. Bye, Susan.
Bye, Susan.
Sleep well. I hate getting up early too. All right, so let's get back into this. Years later, during his cool-off period, like between murders, Rader would take pictures of himself wearing women's clothes with a female mask while bound. He later admitted that he was pretending to be his victims as a part of a sexual fantasy. However, Rader kept his sexual proclivities well hidden, and he was widely regarded in his community as normal, polite, and well-mannered.
He was also the ultimate Karen of all fucking time. Like, he...
Right?
Yeah. During his cooldown period, actually, one of the reasons why they think he cooled down was because he became a dog catcher, basically. And he would just take the dogs legally, like he should, and would go and kill them. Have them killed. And stuff like that. There was one classic process killer status. Yes.
Limp dick piece of shit.
Yep. No. He had kids. He had several kids. He wasn't exactly he could.
Okay, but he meant like he was a piece of shit.
Oh yeah. No. Well, I'm so used to the whole idea of a lot of serial killers have issues with control.
Impotency.
And yeah, they're impotent because they can't control the situation. But the minute they can control the situation, they get a hard on and they're able to do everything.
Unagi power.
Rader was slightly different in that aspect too, because he did have a regular bedroom life with his wife too.
Mm-hmm. So Rader attended Kansas Wesleyan University. I don't know why I couldn't pronounce that, after high school, but received mediocre grades and dropped out after a year. He served in the U.S. Air Force from 66 to 70. Upon discharge, he moved to Park City, a suburb of Wichita, where he worked in the meat department of a Leakers, which was a supermarket, with his mom. With his mom, because she was actually a bookkeeper there. Yes, he pulled a Michael Vick.
Yeah. He, to an extent,
yes.
One of the stories they have of him, he was, he was a dog catcher, and there was a chick he was basically stalking, but he wasn't exactly going after, because this is his cool down period. And he kept telling her, you need to break up with your boyfriend. I don't like him. And he kept telling her that. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, she lost her dog and didn't know what happened to it. Come to find out, he took it, said it was out, took it, and had it put to death. And there was nothing she could do about it in Wichita. Nothing. Because it was he was a dog catcher and basically said, this is what happened.
Well, so he married Paula Dietz on May 22nd, 1971. And they had two children. Carrie and Brian. He attended Butler Community College in El Dorado, earning an associate's degree in electronics in 73. He then enrolled in Wichita State and graduated in 79 with a Bachelor of Science, majoring in Administration of Justice. It's all coming together, right?
Well, there's also something else here, too, that he did during his cool-down period. But when we get to that part, and murders and stuff.
So, Rader initially worked as an assembler for the Coleman Company, an outdoor supply company.
Yeah, if you have any old Coleman stuff, he more than likely touched it, and you should keep it.
He then worked at the Wichita-based office of ADT Security Services from 74 to 88, where he installed security alarms as part of his job, in many cases for homeowners concerned about BTK.
That's the thing. He started realizing how to break into people's houses because he did this. His cooldown period started in the 80s. Mm-hmm. He did from 77 to like 85 or 86 or something like that, or 80, maybe even 87. That's where he did the bulk of his murders. And he learned a lot too from being a security, installing security systems and stuff like that.
Well, he was also a census field operations supervisor for the Wichita area in 89. Before the 1990 federal census. So in May of 91, Rader became a dog catcher and compliance officer in Park City. In this position, neighbors recalled him as being somewhat overzealous and extremely strict, as well as taking special pleasure in bullying and harassing single women.
And that's exactly what I was talking about there. One of the things he did, he enjoyed it. One of the things he actually, I think he was somewhat of a supervisor too in this position.
Okay. He was a compliance officer.
One of the things was his coworkers. He literally started and it was having a little bit of a meeting like in a room of just them. Mm-hmm. And he started to walk up on her like she was prey. And she literally had to snap him out of it. She obviously didn't know that he was BTK at the time.
Yeah.
But he started doing the 1,000-yard stare, walking up on her, getting ready to almost kill her right then and there and do whatever he had to do with her. And she's all, Dennis, Dennis. And he, snapped out of it, went to his regular personality and was laughing and joking with her. And just a second ago, he was in kill mode.
You know, hold on.
Okay.
Keep reading.
Sorry.
So the chief compliance officer of a company is the officer primarily responsible for overseeing and managing regulatory compliance issues within an organization. So, they typically report to the chief executive officer or the chief legal officer. The role has existed at many companies that operate in heavily regulated industries, such as financial services or healthcare, or in this situation, dealing with animals.
Yeah.
And so, I'm sorry, I didn't pull it up. Ivar, that's to answer your question.
Star,
what's up? Hi. So we got the Nightmare Clowns in the house, guys.
Yes. Oh, we forgot to say it with Cosmo.
And Cosmo.
Cosmo's here.
Cosmo is also Nightmare Clowns. I forgot to say it. I'm so sorry, Cosmo. Guys. But yeah, we got Nightmare Clowns in the house. Go ahead and go check them out, guys. Star. They're awesome. Star is amazing.
I was on Star's TikTok the other day.
He could not stop laughing at the
mouth thing that you had on there. I literally was taking a drink of soda or something like that, and I spit it out everywhere laughing on it.
It was pretty funny. I laughed at him because he was laughing at you, and then I saw the video, and I was laughing with you. Yeah.
I was on, babe, check it out. It was like, this is hilarious. Star's awesome.
So... he would take particular pleasure in bullying and harassing single women. And one neighbor in particular, which is the one you were mentioning earlier, complained that he killed her dog for no reason.
Yeah.
We love you too.
We love you too.
Yeah, he killed her dog for no reason.
The reason was is he didn't want her with a guy.
Yeah, basically.
Patronized is what is the word I'm looking for.
Patronized?
Right? Patronized. There you go. Patronized. Every person he patronized, every woman he patronized, he viewed him as his own property.
Ivar made a good point too. Yeah. It sounds like him being in that position was like a power trip.
Oh, exactly. That's exactly what he is a classic sociopath.
Hi, Tia.
He's I would dare say he's more of a sociopath than Evan Kemper.
Okay.
Very much a narcissist, too. Like, that's the whole controlling and all that stuff.
So, Rader was a member of Christ Lutheran Church in Wichita and had been elected president of the church council. He was also a Cub Scout leader, and I tasted that burp. That was IPA.
I'm sorry. I burped through my nose. I'm trying not to be loud because it picks up everything.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Not to go off on another tangent. Okay. I love Dogfish
beer. Squirrel!
And they have, okay, they have a stout that I can't find anymore. That is, it's inspired by Hunter S. Thompson. And it's called Backcountry Stout. You are not going to like that. That's why I even offer it to you. This is a 90-minute hopped dry hop stout. And it's a 9% alcohol. But they have a Hunter S. Thompson stout that is, it's called Backcountry Stout. And it's freaking...
Actually, that's not horrible.
It's hilarious because it's like the, it's the Hunter S. Thompson. It's the Fear and Loathing Las Vegas. Not Fear and Loathing. Yeah, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. Artwork on the whatever, and they actually had permission from Hunter S. Thompson. I think before. I think Dogfish has been around.
There was no turning back. Fuck no, not today. Thank you kindly.
Egads, man, we can't stop here. This is Bat Country. fucking love Hunter
Richard
S. Thompson.
Says I want to hear some stories from some of those Cub Scouts. Ooh.
A lot of them actually, when they found out Dennis Rader who he was. They clammed up his family members. His daughter did write a book, Richard, but she has a new name, but she gave it away when she wrote the book.
So, on July 26, 2005, after Rader's arrest, his wife was granted an emergency divorce, waiving the normal waiting period. In an interview with ABC News in 2019, Rader's daughter, Carrie, said she still writes to her father and has now forgiven him but still struggles to reconcile him with the BTK killer, stating her childhood seemed normal and they were a normal American family.
No. There's, look.
Well, no, that's the thing.
Okay, to a child, maybe.
Well, like, okay. I'm not going to go through what I went through as a child, like, on here, but with all the shit that I went through as a child... Honestly, outwardly, we seemed like a completely normal family.
Well, what I'm saying here, though, his wife, there is no way in that much time she didn't see how weird he was sexually. And well, I'm sorry, I'm still under the idea that that she knew something was up, and she knew that he was BTK.
Dogfish
is pretty good beers.
Ivar says, forgiveness can be easy, but forgetting is very difficult. That, yes, well, absolutely.
That is true, because what's his face from Rochester, the serial killer over there? I can't think of his name. The one with the giant wiener that killed a hooker.
Why do you do this to me every time? Because I can never think of it on the spot.
Arthur Shawcross. Yeah. His daughter knew about everything, and even after basically him making sexual advances to his daughter in prison, he couldn't do anything, but he said, Shawcross actually said that, I would have sex with you right now.
Ew.
And his daughter still kept coming and seeing him, and his everything, you know? Ew. His daughter also wearing a Burzum shirt.
Yeah, I saw that. That was the granddaughter I thought that was wearing the Burzum shirt.
You're right, it was the granddaughter. It was the granddaughter that he said that to. The daughter, no, it was his daughter.
I thought that was his granddaughter with the Burzum shirt.
It was his daughter, and his ex-girlfriend brought her there. Or I could be wrong. Whatever. It was granddaughter.
Someone was wearing a Burzum shirt.
A Burzum shirt.
Burzum.
Hey, you guys are like the Burzum.
Varg's kind of a dick, but he can play a mean guitar.
Varg is an interesting character. I love that.
Varg is a dick.
He is a douche, but he is a very... As all good musicians are, they are weird as fuck.
He's racist as fuck.
Yes. I don't like that aspect of him. But
no.
He is a good musician.
Let's get into the murders. On January 15th, 1974, four members of the Otero family were murdered in Wichita, Kansas. The victims were Joseph Otero, age 38, Julie Otero, age 33, Joseph Otero Jr., age 9, and Josephine Otero, age 11. I'm sorry. I got to mention something about the dad.
Well, we also
apparently, all of the children had to have his name. Joseph and Josephine.
That could also have been the mother. But
just,
I'm pretty sure all of our kids are going to be, you know.
They're not going to be Francis.
Why not?
I just don't know.
Gertrude?
No.
That's my aunt's middle name.
No.
It really is my Aunt Shirley. That's her middle name.
I know. I already have a list of names, so I'll show them to you.
My first.
You've agreed with them.
Born is going to be named after me.
Mom, it's a girl.
Frankie works.
Nope. Violet, you already know.
Yeah, I know.
Sorry, guys. Family matters.
We've been in a family planning way lately.
Family planning way? You know what? Before I show this, let's go to commercial. We'll be right back, guys.
We need people to work our yard and clean our house for us. So we're just going to have kids.
We will be
I'm kidding.
We're going to a quick commercial.
We're having fun.
By the way, if you can see, like, on the corner, we can, like, see us a little bit.
Some little, I guess, secrets here. When you make videos, like Odd Mama, when she makes the commercials and stuff like that, and when I make the intros and stuff, we make them in 16:9, but StreamYard is slightly bigger than 16:9 for the videos. It's video editing and stuff. So you can see our hands going like this on the sides. So we've been having fun with it all night.
So Richard says Frankie does work. LOL, Frankie V.
For me, for a girl, that's a good name, Frankie. And
the serial killer dude whose kid that name start with how much. Oh, I feel bad for the serial killers that have, like, the names that where they get away with shit.
Like what? I'm sorry.
Tell me the names.
Tell me some of the names. I'm curious. I'm legitimately curious.
I believe you.
We believe you.
What's up, Shelby?
Hi, Shelby.
Hey, sis. How are you doing? How are you feeling? I hope you're feeling better. I hope you're healing up. Hey.
No, I'm... Oh, I get what you're saying. Okay.
Sorry, talk to text sometimes.
I see what you're saying. Yeah, it's talk to text. A lot of the kids who find out their parents are serial killers and stuff like that, they end up changing their names and just moving on.
Yeah, well, Charles Manson's son, they changed his name, but that's not the same case.
I'm sorry, not to go off on a squirrel moment here again. Charles Manson was not a serial killer. He didn't kill one person. He didn't.
In prison, he defended himself and killed someone.
But that's anecdotal. They never proved it. Oh. But he did. In prison, he did. In juvie. Because he was released when he was 21.
Yeah.
But Charles Manson just won an LSD and vagina. I hate to put it that way, but that's exactly. Music. And folk music. Charles Manson had to act crazy because of where he grew up in the penal in the system.
Good. I'm glad to hear that.
Oh, that's awesome. But yeah, Charles Manson, that was the same thing his son was saying. He's all, I would have just loved to meet him once or twice.
True.
While he was growing up, his son was saying, my grandparents did the right thing by keeping me from him, but it still would have been cool to at least meet him once or twice.
Yeah. All right. So let's get into here. So we just started off with, oh.
I just committed a sin.
Got beer in your hair?
Spilt beer.
Will make your hair feel good.
Yeah, hops in your hair is pretty good.
All right, so.
Here's a letter.
Here is a letter. I find the newspaper not writing about the poem on Bane unamusing.
I'm sorry, pause real fast. Okay, so this is where I'm saying that BTK is actually smarter than what people think he is. he wrote this letter grammatically wrong and with spelling errors and everything. He did it on purpose, even with his poetry that he sent to the police. He sent multiple letters to the police throughout the years. He purposely did that, and it kept the police thrown off for a long, long time until they caught him with the floppy disk.
So here we go. I find the newspaper not writing about the poem on vain, unamusing. A little paragraph would have enough. I know, it not the media fault. I'm going to read it with all the time.
Yeah, no, read it the way you're supposed to, the way you wrote it.
The police chief, he keep things quiet and doesn't let the public know we're a psycho running around loose, strangling mostly women. There's seven in the ground. Who will be next? How many do I have to kill before I get a name in the paper or some national attention? Do the cop think that all those deaths are not related? Golly gee, yes, the MO is different in each, but look, a pattern is developing.
So at this time, real fast, he wrote this letter 2 years after he killed the Otero family. And the Otero were four people, and then he killed three more. Mind you, his first murders ever were four people at once. Yeah. That's insane.
I just want to read the whole thing.
Sorry,
first.
Go ahead.
So the victims are tied up. Most have been women, phone cut, bring some bondage, matter, sadist tendencies, no struggle outside the death spot, no witnesses, witnesses, except the Vane's kids. They were very lucky. A phone call saved them. I was going to tape the boys and put plastic bags over their head like I did Joseph and Shirley. And then hang the girl. God, oh God, what a beautiful sexual relief that would have been. That would have been. Josephine, when I hung her, really turned me on. Her pleading for mercy, then the rope took hold.
Okay, that's brutal.
Yeah, this is brutal, guys.
That was
sorry.
Brutal. Josephine was a little girl.
She terrible. Helpless, staring at me with wide terror-filled eyes, the rope getting tighter and tighter. You don't understand these things because you're not under the influence of Factor X.
Yeah.
The same thing that made Son of Sam, Jack the Ripper, Harvey Glattman, Boston Strangler, Dr. H.H. Holmes, Pantyhose Strangler of Florida, Hillside Strangler, Ted of the West Coast, and many more infamous character kill, which seems senseless, but we cannot help it. There is no help, no cure, except death or being caught and put away. It a terrible nightmare, but. you see, I don't lose any sleep over it. After a thing like Fox, I could come home and go about life like anyone else. And I will be like that until the urge hit me again. It not continuous, and I don't have a lot of time. It take time to set a kill. One mistake and it all over. Since I about blew it on the phone, handwriting is out, letter guide is too long, and typewriter can be traced too. No. Comma, period.
Well, they can trace
my short poem of death and maybe a drawing. Later on, real picture and maybe a tape of the sound will come your way. How will you know me? Before murder or murders, you will receive a copy of the initials, BTK, period, comma. You keep that copy. The original will show up someday on Guess Who. May you not be the unluck one. PS2. How about some name for me? It's time. Seven down, many more to go. I like the following. How about you? The BTK Strangler, Wichita Strangler, Poetic Strangler, the Bond Age Strangler.
Or Psycho.
Or Psycho.
The Bond Age Psycho.
The Wichita Hangman, the Wichita Executioner.
The Wichita Executioner?
Wait, no. The Garrot Phantom. Fathom. Fathom.
Well, it's
Phantom, but Fathom. Garrot Fathom.
The Asphyxiator.
The Asphyxiator.
The Asphyxiator.
And then he signs a BTK, so apparently he likes BTK the best.
Well, so do the media. That's what they picked.
Let's get over to the comments. Hey, Jackal Demon, what's up?
Hi, Jackal Demon.
What's up? Reminds me of that Cannibal Corpse song from The Bleeding. Yeah.
Face down, dead on the ground. I don't belong in the darkness.
Yeah, it was the Josephine one is the Josephine one's brutal.
That when he mentioned Josephine, that's how they found her. Mm-hmm. And that's how they knew
it was correct.
That's how they knew that letter was correct, because he put details in there. And that part where he wrote that was grammatically right, was spelled right, everything. He was purposely writing the grammar wrong, and it gets on my nerves when people
Nightmare butt. What paragraph is that? Oh my god! That was BTK writing his first letter taunting the police and the media.
He purposely, like we were saying, he purposely...
You can't give yourself a nickname, you tool!
Right. He purposely wrote that wrong, and all the letters he did write, he wrote them wrong.
I'm gonna fall out of my chair.
So
let's get back into this. Woo, blurry. So let's get, I'm going to repeat myself a little bit. On January 15th, 1974, four members of the Otero family were murdered in Wichita, Kansas. The victims were Joseph Otero, age 38, Julie Otero, age 33, Joseph Otero Jr., age 9, and Josephine Otero, age 11. Their bodies were discovered by the family's three older children, Charlie, Danny, and Carmen, who had been at school at the time of the killings. After his 2005 arrest, Rader confessed to killing the Otero family. Rader wrote a letter that had been stashed inside of an engineering book in the Wichita Public Library in October of 1974, which described in detail the killing of the Otero family in January of that year. Between the spring of 74 and the winter of 77, Rader killed three more women. Catherine Bright on April 4th, 1974. Shirley Vane Relford. But he was switching. It's Vian.
Yeah.
March 17th, 1977. And Nancy Fox, where he mentioned the Fox. December 8th, 1977.
I don't remember. It was the 80s. One of the ladies he killed in the '80s, or if it was one of them, that he broke into the house and basically said, every time he broke into the house, he said, "I have a sexual problem," or something along those lines. "I just want to rob you." But there was one of them that he did break into the house and basically said, "I have a sexual problem." And she literally said, "Let's have sex." And
he was like, "Wait,"
didn't know what to do. He ended up murdering her. He murdered her anyway.
So Ivar says definitely sounds like he suffers from schizophrenia or some sort of multiple personality disorder.
No,
is what he wants you
to believe. He wants you to believe that he does not have, he has not been diagnosed with schizophrenia. They have done a ton of psych tests on him. He is basically borderline personality disorder, which encompasses, you know, sociopath and narcissism. And
I would say actually psychopathy and narcissism.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I would say psychopath because he was born at a young age. The minute he started seeing the bondage stuff, he was just
he was born right into it. Yeah. And so he suggested many possible names for himself, including the one that stuck, which is BTK. He demanded media attention in the second letter and was finally announced that Wichita did indeed have a serial killer at large. A poem was enclosed titled "Oh, Death to Nancy," a parody of the lyrics of the American folk song "Oh, Death."
He, like I said, he wasn't stupid. He knew what he was doing. When you actually, I couldn't find him his poetry. There's, I can't think of the book. Maybe it's his daughter.
I couldn't read his poetry.
You can find his poetry, but you can't.
It's all in his writing. He has shitty handwriting.
He has shitty. I can't read cursive. Cursive is terrible.
I can read cursive, and he has shitty handwriting.
But his poetry was spot on. He didn't have grammar errors. He didn't have any of that stuff. Go ahead.
Sorry. In the letter, he claimed to be driven to kill by the X Factor, which he characterized as a supernatural element that motivated Jack the Ripper, Son of Sam, the Hillside Strangler. This is what we were talking about when he read the letter.
Well, that is actually kind of accurate in killers and stuff like that. Once you have a taste for it, it's hard to stop. It's an addiction.
He also talked about intending to kill others, such as Anna Williams, who in 79, at age 63, escaped death by returning home much later than expected. Rader explained during his confession that he became obsessed with Williams and was absolutely livid when she evaded him. He spent hours waiting at her home, but became impatient and left when she did not return home from visiting friends. Maureen Hedge, age 53, was found on May 5th, 1985, at East 53rd Street North between North Webb Road and North Greenwich Road in Wichita. Rader killed her on April 27th and took her dead body to his church.
This is the one where
Lutheran Church.
Well, no, this is also the one he took her there. What year was it again?
I'm about to say it.
Say it. Go ahead.
Where he photographed her body in various bondage positions, and he had previously stored black plastic sheets and other materials at the church in preparation for this murder, and then later dumped the body in a remote ditch.
So,
and he called this his Project Cookie.
The pictures, and we can't show them,
obviously,
on, well, with Facebook, but we could, or Facebook or YouTube, but what do we do?
We're going to be doing a show at some point that goes directly to our website.
Yeah.
So, again,
we can actually get real graphic with this and actually show the stuff off.
PsychoBunnyDC.com. If you guys haven't checked it out yet, go ahead and do so. We do Discord. Have a members only area. So if it asks you for a password, run rabbit run.
But, excuse me, I burped. This is the girl that he dug the grave for and ended up posing himself in the grave with his makeshift camera that
I think that might be.
No, this is it. This is it. He ended up posing for himself in there and then took her to the church and did all this other posing with her. And then he ended up just dumping her on the side of the road because he's fucking lazy.
Oh, okay.
And he's a piece of shit.
Mm-hmm. Members only. I'm scared. Yeah, you know, you kind of should be because we have
we can show everything on there.
Pink Flamingo on there.
We can show ourselves in the full beauty. That's the right of ourselves. One, right?
We have Pink Flamingo.
What's Pink Flamingo?
What was it? Pink Flamingo?
I don't know what the Pink Flamingos are.
With Divine.
Oh, you're right. Okay, there you go. Yeah, that's a good movie.
I love Divine. I love Divine, by the way. I miss her.
I'm sorry, Crybaby. Hairspray. I'm sorry, Hairspray. With Divine, not Crybaby. Crybaby was one of Johnny Depp's movies.
I think we might have Faces of Death on there.
I hate Faces of Death and Traces of Death because it's fucking cheesy as fuck. And
but I also
love it because I watched those when I was a kid.
Psycho Bunny DC, Run Rabbit Run.
Yep. All right.
What the hell? It like edited out what you said, and you didn't say anything bad.
No.
Definitely a piece of shit. I don't know if he's lazy. Yeah.
No, I hate to say it this way. The fact that he dug a grave for a chick, then posed himself in the grave. He was ready to bury her there. Took her to the church. Made her, posed her himself after she was dead. And then instead of taking her back to the grave, he just literally dumped her on the side of the road. I think almost from like a moving car.
So in 1988, after the murders of three members of the Fager family in Wichita, a letter was received from someone claiming to be the BTK killer, in which the author of the letter denied being the perpetrator of the Fager murders. The author credited the killer with having done admirable work. It was not proven until 2005 that the letter was in fact written by Dennis Rader. He is not considered by the police to have committed this crime, though. Two women who Rader stalked in the 80s, one who he stalked in the mid-90s, filed restraining orders against him. One of them also changed her address just to avoid him.
Yeah.
His final victim, Dolores E. Davis, was found on February 1st, 1991 at West 117th Street North and North Meridian Street in Park City. Rader killed her on January 19th. So let's get into cold cases.
I don't think... Well, with the cold cases, I just...
Nadine!
The cold cases, though, like, he was very wanting to tell, like, he was wanting to tell what he did. And I just don't believe a lot. I think the cold cases, they're trying to dump a lot of stuff onto him just to get off the record.
So by 2004, the investigation of the BTK killer was considered a cold case. Then Rader initiated a series of 11 communications to local media. This activity led directly to his arrest in February of 2005. In March 2004, the Wichita Eagle received a letter from someone using the name Bill Thomas Killman.
Oh.
The author of the letter claimed that he had murdered Vicky Wedgery on September 16th, 1986. Wow, 2 days before I was born.
I forgot about that one. The Bill,
and enclosed...
Bill Thomas Killman. It's actually pretty crafty.
And enclosed photographs of the crime scene and a photocopy of her driver's license, which had been stolen at the time of the crime. Now, this is reminding me of a movie.
Which movie?
The one where he was tying the knots, where the kid suspected his dad of being the murderer and followed him and discovered he was, and he was, they were calling him, the Clover Hitch. That's his call. That's what it's called. Cause he was tying a Clover Hitch knot at each one of the places that he was going to kill or had killed.
I've actually never seen this movie, and
It's newer. It was actually pretty good because it was basically,
you know what we need to see.
It was kind of like BTK. He was keeping the driver's license, and there was a stash of porn, and he had a torture chamber underneath. And it was crazy. It was kind of like BTK and kind of not, but I'll show it to you. And I know you're gonna say Black Phone, huh?
I really want to see Black Phone. I'm waiting for
Black Phone.
Freaking, I absolutely loved The Northman. And that movie was awesome. We went and saw it last weekend. Was it last week?
The Northman was so good.
But I'm Chris Evans. What's his name?
Who's Alexander Skarsgård?
No, his father in that. He's playing the main murderer in Black Phone.
Ethan Hawke?
Ethan Hawke. I fucking love Ethan Hawke.
So Ivar said, so how many murders did he go down for 10. Compared to how many he admitted to?
He admitted 10. To 10 and he went
and
down.
And he actually went down for 10.
I don't believe.
Just watched Clover Hitch a few days ago. Isn't it good? It's actually pretty good.
I have to watch it now.
It's slow but good.
Well, okay, so he is not like other serial killers, like I said at the start of this. He did not fluff up his numbers. He didn't try to say he did more or less or whatever. He actually told people, he told the cops what he liked. I know the AC cut off right now for
I'm
some
burning
reason.
Up.
But he was very verbal with what he did and didn't go beyond it. I really do believe he only killed 10 people.
So let's get back into this. Unlike Billy here in Aberdeen, yes.
Oh, this is...
Yes.
Oh, okay.
He's the one who told me that we needed to talk about Billy Gould.
We were talking about it the other day, and I was like...
Because we're going to look up some more information on him.
Liz was telling me, like, oh, he was suspected of killing, like, 300 people, and I was like...
100.
100?
He went down for 2 and is suspected of killing 100.
And I was, like, insane. I was like, you know, he might have been suspected of it because he was just trying to beef himself up, like they all do.
But...
It's hard to do... Well, the time... Okay. It's easy to do, but it's also hard to do at the time because no one's going to pay attention from state to state what you do in those times.
Well, it was people that were traveling over on ship. He was murdering the sailors.
Yeah. Well, that's actually hard because the sailors were...
They didn't have family in port.
Had nothing to do with family. They were workers. It's hard to kill workers.
Well, we'll get into that later. Ivar, we will cover this.
Ivar, you started us on something. Maybe we should bring Ivar in and have him talk about it with us.
Yes, if you're down, Ivar.
Yeah, Ivar, if you're down.
We always love having guests.
Look, if you come down to California.
Well, he can also join us here.
I know.
Of course, if you come to California, you're welcome. Sorry, sure. Yay!
I listen to black metal. We listen to black metal. We listen to some folk metal with you.
Ooh, it's hot right now.
It's getting hot in here.
Oh, wait, what? We didn't go to that part?
I
forgot
the words.
Okay, so you need to warm up. I need to get cold. I am burning up right now. Let me get into here because I squirreled again. So before this, it had not been definitive that BTK killed Vicky Wedgerly.
California, here I come.
Woo-woo!
We're only 16 hours from you, I think. Is it 16?
She's...
Ivar, where are you at?
I was trying to say she, as in Vicky here, was killed by BTK. And now I got confused.
Sorry.
Talking about? Okay, Ivar, he's in Aberdeen.
Oh!
Washington, not Maryland.
Okay.
Aberdeen, Washington.
I always think of New Kids in the Block or New Kids in the...
It's cool.
Kids in the Hall.
You can ask him earlier. I was all, I was thinking of
Kids in the Hall. There was Scott's. Well, it was Scott Hall, and he was playing an Italian maid or something like that, an Italian old lady.
And okay, then he was all,
he kept saying, Aberdundi. Like it was a skit. Sorry. And I'm completely squirreled out on that. I
live where the murders took place.
You live in Washington. That's like the serial killer capital of the United States. That's all of it.
Okay.
I'm kidding.
So now I lost track again. Thank you. So she was killed by BTK. DNA collected from under her nails provided police with previously unknown evidence. They then began DNA testing hundreds of men in an effort to find the serial killer. Altogether, more than 1,300 DNA samples were taken and later destroyed by court order. In May of 2004, television station K-A-K-E.
Cack?
Khaki.
Khaki.
Cack.
Cack in the crack.
Television station Cack.
Cack.
In a... Oh wait, and they're in Kansas, so they said kick. And Wichita received a letter with chapter headings for the BTK story, fake IDs, a word puzzle. On June 9th.
He made a word puzzle?
Yep. On June 9th. Jesus
Christ, man.
A package was found in Kack.
Sorry.
Kack found a package. The package was found taped to a stop sign at the corner of First and Kansas Roads in Wichita.
Okay, that just fed his ego right there.
It had graphic descriptions of the Otero murders and a sketch labeled "The Sexual Thrill Is My Bill."
The fact that he was able to tape it to a stop sign, someone found it, and then gave it to the news or whatever they did with it, and that fed his ego right there. I'm crushing you. I'm crushing you.
Yes!
Yes. Thank you, Richard. Now it's stuck in my head, and I have to go listen to freaking Emperor for the millionth time
today.
Today,
I was listening to that song earlier.
Oh,
yes. You're so funny. Try Squish Bros. Head them all. I'm crushing your head.
Are you crushing your head? Oh, what's this? You have a problem? I will not squish your head. And when you took care of the drunk lady. I will get you home. Oh, you are a very strong head. I can't crush you. Ah, I have my hand. The muscle guy. Kids in the Hall.
Mm-hmm.
They're back. They're on Apple TV, and that's gonna make me want to get Apple TV right there because I fucking love
it. I had a whole year of Apple TV that we never accepted. Well,
Kids in the Hall is what Lorne Michael did right. Because the new
BTK part two,
the new SNL stuff is just dog shit.
BTK part two on Sunday. Because look at all this stuff.
You want to do it on Sunday? We can get into the victims and everything on Sunday, and then we can go into some fun stuff and just hang out. We can talk about victims of a serial killer, and then we'll hang out and keep talking about murder and stuff like that.
So, you know what, guys? We have hit our hour mark a little bit over. So, we're going to talk about this cold case and him doing puzzles and communicating with CAC.
A-K-E.
CAC.
You got to put the asterisk above the E so it can be khaki. Would they be
tan? Boo!
Would their colors be tan? My khaki pants? Did you say boo? Why did you say boo?
Khaki.
Khaki, boo, khaki, boo, boo, khaki.
The best part is I got you.
Oh, did you just say boo? You're khaki, like Oh, just grow up.
No.
Why don't you just fucking grow up?
No. You love me. All right, guys. Thank you all for joining us tonight. I'm glad we can make you laugh.
We'll get the feed and everything set up for Sunday night, and we'll
thank you for joining us, Ivar.
Guys, go look at our Discord. I think I have the banner here.
Oh yeah, Discord, guys, Discord.
Banner.
I know.
I don't know where it's at. I put it on here somewhere. Guys, right there, go to our Discord. That's where we can do a lot of the unrated murder stuff. I was going to say the unrated XXX porn murder stuff, but that's bad. That's snuff films, and we can't do that anywhere.
Of course.
But
cheers, foo. Stay safe.
Go to our Discord. Go to our website. And
PsychoBunnyDC.com. PsychoMantium13.com. RootsBleedRed.com. Go check them all out. Go check out our Discord. Go check out the members only area on PsychoBunnyDC.com.
Steve the Cat
will be on Monday. He is back, guys.
Out of the Ordinary on Tuesday.
Mikey with Out of the Ordinary will be on Tuesday. And we are planning some special stuff this week. Who knows? Well, Bunny might come back at some point.
We have one more episode to record for our podcast with Mother de la Mort.
Yeah.
And that will, once we get that new episode recorded, which we're not releasing what we're going to be recording.
Did you hear what I said?
Sorry.
Bunny might be back.
Yay. Yas. But no, we have to record one more episode but we have to record one more episode for our podcast.
Thank you for joining.
Then you can find us on Spotify, Amazon Music, and all that stuff. So.
Woo! I'm burning up. Yes. I need a hair tie.
We'll come back on Sunday. We'll talk about the victims. We'll get more into it. And if we get done early, we'll just hang out and talk about murder and psychology and all that other stuff.
So. It's hot.
It's hot. Guys?
I don't know where my outro is. Hold on.
Have a good night. There's an outro somewhere. There it is.
Bye!